There are so many things that have been said about music. It was very difficult to select just a few, so I'm sorry, Ernie, there won't be time for a sermon today. I did manage to hold it to four. Here's Elton John said, "Music has healing power. It has the ability to take people out of themselves for a few hours." And Bruce Springsteen said, "The best music is there to provide you with something to face the world with." I like that one. Taylor Swift said that people haven't always been there for her, but music has. And Pat Conroy said that without music, life is a journey through a desert.
Amen. Let me hear an amen.
Amen.
Whoa. Okay, sermon's over, you can go home.
Amen. Skip over our reading too.
Maybe we should all go back and come back in maybe. Well, we'll just go on, proceed. There's Orpheus. Is anybody familiar with Orpheus? Okay, he's a prototype. Part of his myth is prototypical of Jesus, the gentle shepherd. And in this picture, he's playing the lute or the harp or whatever. And you see all the animals surrounding Orpheus. Orpheus, for some people, is a myth, and some people believe he really lived, but regardless of how you think of him, he's sort of a symbol of the gateway to civilization and culture, and the fact that through his music, he's able to tame the wild beast. And I'm sure most of you have heard the saying, music soothes the Sabbath beast. Now, I looked that up and I was unable to find out if it's music soothes the savage breast or music soothes the savage beast. But in this depiction, Orpheus is the one who, through his music and songs, is able to soothe the beast and thus civilize humanity, because really the beast is within us. That instinctual animal light that lives in us, but Orpheus's music is able to civilize and soothe the beast. And that's a depiction of Orpheus there playing for the animals. His dates vary, but somewhere around 1000 BCE, anywhere before. And there's lots of stories about Orpheus, but I'll let you look those up if you're interested in Orpheus. The one phrase that sticks to my mind when I think about music is a response by Louis Armstrong. Because after a jazz concert, a jazz fan comes up to Louis and says, "What is the meaning of jazz?" And I love his response. He says, "If you have to ask, you'll never know." I love that. You know, Jim was saying that lots of things have been said about music, but it's really difficult, if not impossible, to wrap our heads around music. And as much as we try, you know, we try to formulate music in some sort of way that our minds can comprehend them. It's almost impossible. But music is something that it's the non-visual art, but it surpasses images and words. We just can't seem to wrap our minds around it. Not that it's meaningless, but that it transcends to me. It transcends meaning. It transcends reason and rationality. We don't quite understand how the power of music affects us, but it does. Can't really describe it in terms of a dictionary definition. Friedrich Nietzsche says, "Music resists adequate treatment by language, for the simple reason that music symbolizes a sphere that is both beyond and earlier than language." Franz Liszt said this, "Because in such case the words tend to destroy the magic, to desecrate the feelings, and to break the most delicate fabric of the world, which has taken this form just because they are incapable of formulation in words or images or ideas." We really don't know how the power of music affects us, but it does. We have a difficult time, especially if we want to approach it from our heads, you know, we want to intellectualize it. We want to approach it from some rational, reasonable, explain how it works, but it's just nearly impossible to do that. throughout history, music has been treated every from every angle, from being the lowest to the highest cultural form. It's been approached by logical positivism, and nowadays it's being approached from the viewpoint of psychology and even neurology. Neurologists are doing a lot of research in music now, trying to figure out how it affects our nervous system and all that. Again, this logical approach. But I always go back, I'll always go back to Louis Armstrong. If you have to ask, you'll never know. You know, there's just some things we can't know. We have this huge appetite to know everything. But there's just some things we can't know that are a mystery. It's unfortunate that music, if we want to know about music in our local area or anywhere, we go to the entertainment section of the newspaper, as if music is some sort of just luxury for entertainment. And I, you know, if it was up to me, I would put music in the headlines, or I would put music in the medical section of the newspaper. You know, as people's music goes, so they go. We treat music as if it's some kind of a commodity, yet I believe in my heart of hearts that music is a necessity. And I think one of Jim's quotes referred to that, that without music, life would be a desert. Without music, life would be, in my opinion, be empty without music. Now we do know this, we do know that music speaks to the emotional life. It speaks to the emotions, and it comes from the emotional life. So just for a moment, I want us to reflect on emotional life. We are primarily emotional beings. Long before we became conscious beings, we were emotional beings, moved by our emotions. Because the emotional life is primary, you know, neurologists put the emotions in the, what they call the middle brain, the limbic system, which is right above, and I, you know, I'm not a neurologist, but this is just what I gather, that you've got this reptilian brain, snake brain, and then it takes care of all the regulatory stuff, your heartbeat, blood flow. Above that, you have the limbic system. And then built on top of that, we humans have the cerebral cortex. Well, music for most neurologists has to do with the limbic system. Now, one of the things that has been discovered lately is that the reptilian brain tells the limbic system, talks to the cerebral cortex, and the cerebral cortex is the one that says, no, you don't want to do that. Or, yeah, you want to do that. But what they're saying now is that it works the other way too. The cerebral cortex can communicate downward to the reptilian brain, and so you know, we can listen to music, and that old snake brain will calm down. You know, that's where all the stressors are, in that reptilian brain. So you listen to good music, and it just kind of works down and reduces the stress. Now that's what neurologists say that music can do. It can reduce the stress. And my God, we're living in a stressful situation right now.
Amen.
High anxiety all over the world. We can do with some good music. Because the limbic system and the emotions are considered to be the lower primary part of the brain-mind, they're the first to come and the last to go. Now, music is the first to come and the last to go. We may lose our conscious minds, our sense of self or personhood may deteriorate, as in cases of Alzheimer's, but we won't lose that deep connection to music. If you ever get a chance to watch a video, Alive Inside, you watch the power of music among patients who are diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and you see them come alive. You see them sing songs to remember words. They just come alive. We come alive. Because music is really at core. You know, the question of what is the meaning of jazz, that question, you know, that was asked to Louis Armstrong, could probably be answered if we could answer the question, what's the meaning of an emotion? You know, I can give you a dictionary definition of an emotion, but what's the meaning of an emotional experience? What's the meaning of fear? What's the meaning of joy? What's the meaning of experiencing enchantment? You know, what does that mean? You know, I can give you the dictionary definition, I can put in words, but, you know, the experience is different, the experience is unique. We swim in an ocean of emotion. Einstein's E equals MC squared, energy equals mass plus the speed of light, isn't that what that means? That we're carriers of light, energy. Well, emotion is the same thing. Emotion, just drop E from emotion. E is the energy. Motion is the movement of the energy. We are emotional beings. We swim in an ocean of emotion. Every moment we are experiencing emotions. They may not be powerful. They may be very weak, but every moment. And this is the important thing to know. You and I did not create the emotions. My emotions are not mine. Yours are not yours. Emotions are universal. They're collective. They're eternal. We rest on an ocean of emotion. We did not create those emotions. They're not my personal being. I either learn to relate to them or I don't relate to them. We don't have emotions. They have us. It's important to remember. We didn't create them. We share them with our furthest ancestors. We share them with the generations to come. But we did not create them. And for our ancestors, emotions were understood to be part of the divine. Gods and goddesses, emotions were not part of the conscious mind, they were part of the unconscious mind, and they were associated with the gods and goddesses. If you're familiar with the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, God is, does anybody know what God is? God is a jealous God. First commandment, love me with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, don't have any other gods before me, because I am a jealous God. And the very next word is, I will punish. I will punish those of you who disobey my commandments, and I will reward those who obey my commandments. And if you know anything about the Hebrew Bible, the God of the Hebrew Bible is moving back and forth from rage to pity, from rage to pity. Those are emotions. Now, jealousy is a very complex emotion. Because jealousy includes rage, it includes envy, it includes a sense of unworthiness. So, the Old Testament God is a God who has to have you to love Him. And if you don't, He's a jealous God. And He'll punish you. Now, I'm not saying you're wrong if you embrace that mythology. That's fine with me. But I find that mythology kind of hard to embrace. You know, and there's that problem that Job had, that Job loved God, but then Satan puts a little bug in God's ear. You need to be suspicious about Job, because he loves you because you reward him. You know, you take away his reward, the rewards, and he won't love you. So that, you know, that caused a problem. I'm digressing. I need to get back to music. Sorry. But I mean, what I was thinking about, what is, if there's music for everything, what is the music of jealousy? And I looked it up, and sure enough, there are songs you can Google, and they're even called jealousy. So there's music that matches that, those feelings of jealousy, of rage and anger. Music derives from the Greek word muse. And there were nine goddesses who presided over the arts of music. They inspired the composers to write music and write poetry. So music offers us really the sound of the emotional life. Music not only composes the emotional life, but music puts us in touch with the emotional life. Music can even awaken within us emotions that we've never experienced before. The English romantic poet William Wordsworth once said, "Poetry is emotion recollected in tranquility." Poetry is music recollected in tranquility. In other words, you have an emotional experience. You can go to a place where you can be tranquil and you write a nice poem about it. Well, I would say that the music is emotion composed in tranquility. The composer not only feels deeply the emotions, but is able to compose those emotions into sounds and tunes. I mean, if music was nothing but emotion, we'd all be great musicians, even though I do believe that every one of us has music living inside of us. We're not always that good at composing it into sounds and tones, like great composers, Beethoven, Mozart, Bach, people like that. We're able to compose that music. Music, in my opinion, is deep calling to deep. Music is deep calling to deep. There's this beautiful scene in one of Andre Rieu's concerts in Tuscany where an opera singer is singing O Mio Bambino by Puccini. And the cameraman whips over to this older man, and she's right in the middle of her song, and the tears start to come. He starts crying. And I see that and I say, you know, this is deep calling to deep. Mm-hmm. The depth of this music calling to the depths of this person's emotions. Now, music soothes the savage beast, but it also can arouse the beast within us. Because when I was a student in Hendersonville High School, we did this thing we called hood surfing. And we'd put on the radio, Born to be Wild, and we'd turn it all the way up, and we'd get on the hood of the car and drive down the highway at 60 miles an hour. Born to be wild, so yeah. Music can arouse the emotions in all kinds of different ways, but, you know, imagine that Scottish the Brave, you know, that war song, marching into battle with that. So music has that power, really, of a deep calling to the deep within us. Now here's something, I'm winding down now, okay? Here's something from the neurologist that I got off of Google. The calming effect induced by classical music releases dopamine to spike pleasure. The dopamine prevents the release of stress hormones. From here, mood is improved, which therefore clarifies thinking, making tasks like essay writing and studying a lot more enjoyable. I've noticed I can read better when I have Mozart in the background. Now here's the way I think about classical music and the music that I prefer. You know, I'm a Mozart fan, and I'm not saying you have to be, but it'd be good if you were. No, just kidding. I'm just kidding. But that's all I listen to, Mozart. And I was going to play a piece for you of Mozart, but I found this one by Beethoven that works better. It's Pathanique, I think is the way you pronounce it. Do we have that, Don? Wake up, brother.
Pathetique. Okay, wait a minute, before you play it. Here's what I listen to when I, okay, it may not come on, huh?
No, just click on it.
All right, wait, hold on before you play it. What I listen to when I listen to classical music is I listen to two things. I listen to the melody on top, and I listen to the rhythm underneath it. And go ahead and play it, and I'll stop talking.
Let's see if I know how.
Well, if it doesn't play, that's fine, because you can go away and listen to it. But the way I think about that is that rhythm underneath it, that beat underneath the melody, that's the deep emotions that carry us in life. That's the rhythm of life. That's the heartbeat of life. Above that is the melody. Now, the melody is you and me. That's
what's actually causing you to have blurry vision.
There you go. Right there. It's too bad you didn't see what's causing me a blurry sound. Okay, that melody, that's the individual life. That's you and me. Underneath that, the rhythm of life, the heartbeat of life, the eternal life. I see that. That's the way I listen to that. And that song has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And that's life. You and I are born, we live, we die. But that beat underneath there, that keeps going. That rhythm, that keeps going. So you and I are just melodies playing out. And that song, if you listen to it long enough, it'll reach sort of apex, you know, the storm of life, sort of the middle of life. Mm-hmm. And then it'll, what's the word, musicians? Crescendo, or what is that called? What? Damon. Damon. Crescendo?
Decrescendo.
Okay.
Diminuendo.
So, I mean, we can stop this if you want to listen to it. Let's listen to it. But listen to those two things now. Thank you. thank you all for listening.
Drinking warm water before bed.
I love it. Nietzsche says, "Error is a part of life." If we went through life without errors, we'd be empty people. When Libby died, it said that Mark Twain walked into a room where the piano wasn't played that song after Libby died. I was sitting on the couch with my then 3-year-old grandson. He's 9 now, so that was, you know, some years ago, but we were playing, listening to music, and he started crying. And I said, "Ryan, what's the matter?" And he said, "That music is so sad." So here's a 3-year-old who the depth of his sadness is speaking to some depth in him, that even as a child he could feel that sadness in that music. You know, a lot of classical music is kind of sad, but some happy. When I think of music, I think of that undercurrent that's really carries the word, that carries our lives. And when I think about the civil rights movement and the protest songs of the 60s, you know, that's the way I think about this. I personally wouldn't start a movement if I didn't have people coming and singing songs. And I wouldn't want to have a worship service without music in it too, because, you know, in my opinion, music is the highest expression of the human spirit. And it exceeds words and languages and language. And it's universal. If you ever get a chance to see the video where they take the song, what is the song? They take it around the world.
Music for Change.
Music for Change. And each country, Russia, China, they all add to this song that goes around the world. And just showing how, you know, the power of music to bring us together and to unite us. But anyway, we're going to sing 2 songs, one from the 60s and one from the Civil Rights Movement. And, you know, we invite you to sing along with us, and that'll be the close of our service. The first one is by Bob Dylan, Blowing in the Wind. I invite you to sing along. And don't be shy, let her rip.
Just as Sing that.
that song, when nothing is going your way, you are on top of the world. Amen. Have a good day. A refreshment's over here for those of you who are visiting or guests. Imagine. Yes, we're going to sing Imagine by John Lennon.
Oh,
thank you. And he said, thank you. At least one person said, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes. That's my favorite.
I'm getting ahead. I don't know why I'm ahead of myself. I'm sorry about that. I skipped a bunch of stuff, but that's all right.
All right.